Fund. We use it to bring encouragement to those who are going through difficult times, through grief, through several different circumstances. It's our way of showing small acts of kindness and love to those in our community and our church as well. And next week, so you have a big announcement on the insert. Next week, we are having our outdoor service. We are having kind of our end of summer church party, meaning outdoor service, followed by a big barbecue afterwards. So there is a sign-up sheet if you want to bring any sides. Dick and I are actually going to grill right after the service ends. So we're going to have plenty of food. And we're going to make it a joyous event. Okay. Lastly, I want to just announce the Rooted campaign that we started in July is going very well. So first I want to say thank you, because we've only, I think, just starting to send out thank yous, and they probably haven't arrived yet. But for all of the pledges that have come in, and we've gotten many pledges coming in already, thank you. We have had a great start, and it's only been not quite a month yet. So we are very excited by our proceeding with the timeline that we presented, with what's happening already this, I guess you could say, fall with the painting and a new sign that will go up. So be on the lookout for things that are already starting, okay? So I think that is the only, yes, those are my only announcements. Yes? Okay, let's continue our service. Counsel of the upright and in the assembly. Great are the works of the Lord. They are pondered by all who delight in them. Glorious and majestic are his deeds, and his righteousness endures forever. He has caused his wonders to be remembered. The Lord is gracious and compassionate. He provides food for those who fear him. He remembers his covenant forever. He has shown his people the power of his works, giving them the lands of other nations. The works of his hands are faithful and just. All his precepts are trustworthy. They are established forever and ever, enacted in faithfulness and uprightness. He provided redemption for his people. He ordained his covenant forever. Holy and awesome is his name. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All who follow his precepts have good understanding. To him belongs eternal praise. Amen. Why don't you stand and worship with me this morning?
Thank you. covered by sin and shame. I heard mercy call my name. He rolled the stone away.
Continue to pray for Don Osborne, who's
In hospice, well, at home.
Home.
At home hospice. That's what you call it. And Larry as well, who is at home hospice as well. Larry Shield.
Prayers of thanksgiving for my niece, who is getting married this Friday. So.
Oh, that's right. You leave this week. Travel for Wendy and.
Prayers for our friend Zoe, who is suffering, and the doctors can't figure out what's wrong.
Is it? What did you say?
Zoe. Zoe.
Oh. Oh. Okay.
Thanks for having Shirley
join
us today.
Yeah. Anybody else? Diana.
Prayers of thanks to God for my mother's recovery from a broken arm.
Yes.
I'd
like to pray for our students, our children that are returning to school.
Return to school is right around the corner. For some already happening, I think, this week.
I have a message from Lynn Keating, who says, thank you for answered prayers, healing nicely from surgery. See you all next week.
Yes, Lynn Keating had surgery on her gallbladder and stomach, I believe. And Deb had surgery on her eyes as well.
Prayers for Don Pollard.
And Don Pollard. Okay. And prayers for your husband, right, Deb?
Surgery will be coming up at Mayo in September.
Okay. All right, let's be praying. Pray with me. God, we thank you for your presence. We thank you that you are God, that you are in control, that you sit on the throne. We worship you. For you are good. Your faithfulness and love endures forever. We thank you for being with those family members, friends who have visited with us, who are with us today, who we've been able to see and create more memories with, the treasures that we have in them. We do pray for all the names lifted up this morning. We pray for those who are nearing end of life. We pray for their families. We pray for peace upon their hearts. Pray for comfort and endurance in this time. We pray for those that are struggling physically as well, facing surgery, facing even recovery. We pray for healing. We pray for strength upon their bodies. Pray strength upon their minds as well as they're going through these times. Pray for those that are going through difficult times mentally and emotionally. We pray for your light to just shine on them. And may all of us, those who are surrounding each one in need, bring comfort, bring encouragement, bring love, and bring even a measure of healing in your name and in your presence because of you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Join me with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven. Hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning, y'all.
Good morning.
My name is Katie Humphrey. I live in Racine, Wisconsin, but I'm a guest of Jan Evans with my brothers this week. We have been frequent visitors to their cottage since we were small children. They have created a space that's just wonderfully welcoming to all. You may recall a few of you that were here a few years ago. I played my French horn with Dave Evans, who's no longer with us, but I believe his spirit is with us today. I have a few songs, or two songs exactly, to play with you, and I'm accompanied by this little box, which is a relic from my children from many years ago. It's called a CD player. So it's going to accompany me. I'm going to play two songs. They go back to back because that's how the CD rolls. So the first one is Holy, 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 which I think you'll recognize. And the second one is I Need Thee Every Hour. So feel free to sing along if you want to. All right.
Thank you.
faithfulness endures forever. We thank you for your blessings that you bestow upon us. We thank you for this opportunity to show our thanks, to show our act of worship to you and all your loving kindness. May you use them, may you multiply them for your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. The first reading this morning is from 2 Samuel chapter 7, verses 1 through 17. After the king was settled in his palace and the Lord had given him rest from all his enemies around him, he said to Nathan the prophet, "Here I am, living in a house of cedar, while the ark of God remains in a tent." Nathan replied to the king, "Whatever you have in mind, go ahead and do it, for the Lord is with you." But that night the word of the Lord came to Nathan, saying, "Go and tell my servant David, this is what the Lord says. Are you the one to build me a house to dwell in? I have not dwelt in a house from the day I brought the Israelites up from out of Egypt to this day. I have been moving from place to place with a tent as my dwelling. Wherever I have moved with all the Israelites, did I ever say to any of their rulers, whom I commanded to shepherd my people Israel, 'Why have you not built me a house of cedar?' Now then, tell my servant David, this is what the Lord Almighty says. I took you from the pasture, from tending the flock, and appointed you ruler over my people Israel. I have been with you wherever you have gone, and I have cut off your enemies before you. Now I will make your name great, like the names of the greatest men on earth, and I will provide a place for my people Israel, and will plant them so they can have a home of their own and no longer be disturbed. Wicked people will not oppress them anymore as they did at the beginning, and have done ever since I appointed leaders over my people Israel. I will also give you rest from all your enemies. The Lord declares to you that the Lord himself will establish a house for you. When your days are over and you rest with your ancestors, I will raise up your offspring to succeed you, your own flesh and blood, and I will establish his kingdom. He is the one who will build a house for my name. I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be his father, and he will be my son. When he does wrong, I will punish him with a rod wielded by men, with floggings inflicted by human hands. But my love will never be taken away from him, as I took it away from Saul, whom I removed from before you. Your house and your kingdom will endure forever before me. Your throne will be established forever." Nathan reported to David all the words of this entire revelation. The second reading is from Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1 through 16. "As a prisoner for the Lord, then, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope that you were called. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But to each of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. This is why it says, 'When he ascended on high, he took many captives and gave gifts to his people.' What does 'he ascended' mean, except that he also descended to the lower earthly regions? He who descended is the very one who ascended higher than all the heavens in order to fill the whole universe. So Christ himself gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, and the teachers to equip his people for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith, in the knowledge of the Son of God, and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Then we will no longer be infants tossed back and forth by the waves, blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of people in their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will grow to become in every respect the mature body of him who is the head, that is, Christ. From him, the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. This is the word of the Lord. Please stand.
So there's a slight Y sound right before the T. So you could say bait.
Bait.
Right? Can you get it?
Bait.
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 Bait. Some of you will get it. If not, what I want to teach you about is the first meaning that this word has is house. It can also mean castle or temple. Now we've been following David's journey, and in this section, David has become king, and he has solidified national unity. He has solidified the national capital at this point as Jerusalem. And at this point, we know that the ark has come and is dwelling in the tent of meeting in Jerusalem. Now, at this time, in this age as well, when a king has established such strength for his nation, for his people, the natural thing to do is what? Is to give thanks for the God that you serve, who helped you become strong, helped you become a nation. So it's somewhat common in this day to feel like it's time to go ahead and erect a statue, erect a temple, and we see that in the people groups around. Now, David comes and he says, I am living in a castle. I have this castle of cedar. It's beautiful. I came from living outside, tending sheep. This is quite a change for a shepherd boy. This is the, do you still say Cinderella story? Even though it's okay. Okay. And he is feeling grateful. Okay, and so he says to God, you know what, you're in a tent. How does that compare? Because I definitely know at this point, in handling the ark and handling all the battles, that God is holy and he is to be worshipped and adored. And so it doesn't seem right to him to have a tent house the ark, which is the basically the symbol of God's presence, okay? And at first, which I think is interesting, he talks to the prophet Nathan, and Nathan says, you know what, go ahead and do what you think is best. Because I think God wanted to see what David would say or do. But then very quickly, God comes to Nathan and says, actually, this is what you need to say to Nathan. Now, I've titled this People, Place, or Thing. If you don't know, that was based on a popular 20 questions, which is still, I think, a popular thing to do. You don't have to play 20 questions. But we're going to start backwards. We're going to start from thing, okay? Now, bit means house. It means castle. And so we see this sharp reply from God saying, are you really going to be the one to build me a house? Do you really think you could build something that's worthy of me? Do you think that you could build something that actually hosts who I am? Now remember, in this passage, he tells Nathan, remember, I never asked for a temple at this point, just the tent of meeting, which
does have a symbolism of heaven itself in the holy place, in the most holy place. But I was in this tent because I was always moving with my people. You see, I wasn't ever fixed in one place. The ark and all of the tent and all of things went with the people, and in fact, was where with the people when they were moving? In front. Often traveled in front. The ark often preceded the people's traveling into new countries, new territory. And this is what we want to look at. You see, God uses things for His glory. He uses things to point to Him. And so we see this. I want to add a few facts because I found this interesting when I was doing some research. So Solomon is the son of David, and we know he's the one to build the temple. Okay? Which I find an interesting contrast because at first it sounds like God is saying to David, you know what, I don't want to be contained in the building. Right? I want to make sure that you realize that I'm not stuck in one place. But Solomon builds a temple, and God uses the temple as a symbol for the nation that he is present to them. But shortly after Solomon, in fact, it was Solomon's son, right after Solomon dies, that's when the nation splits. Okay? They split into two kingdoms, the northern and southern kingdom. And it is at this time that 10 tribes are part of the northern kingdom, and the two tribes are part of the southern kingdom. Okay, that's Benjamin and Judah. And in fact, that's how we end up with Jews eventually, from the nation of Judea, Jews. Okay? And very soon after Solomon's reign ends, we see the decline of the entire nation, meaning it just dissolves piece at a time until the northern kingdom is taken over by a people group called the Assyrians, and the southern kingdom is eventually taken over by the Babylonians. And we know that story. They're taken into Babylonian captivity. Now, where am I going with this? You see, the temple is built, then it's destroyed, it's built again, then it's destroyed. But we have to remember that God is not contained in the building. But He constantly is using things to point to Him. And what is the thing that we know points to God that we use as a symbol? Thank you. We don't worship the cross, right? Thank you. I got a little nervous there. The cross is a symbol of Jesus Christ and who we worship. So we use the cross to remember Him. There were other symbols, though, as well, that pointed to Jesus. Now, whoever was into history, what other symbols did Christians use to point to God?
The fish,
thank you, because that's gonna be on our sign. So the cross, the fish. Does anybody know any other symbols?
The dove.
The dove. Anybody else? That's a tough one. Mm. But early on, for a little while, it was a circle. Why? What was that?
Eternity, or?
To represent the tomb, the stone wall.
Oh, the stone
wall. Okay. And we have, of course, the symbol of the cup and the loaf, right? We obviously don't worship any of these things, but again, when we see them, we think, it's Jesus, right? So, we have these things that are representing God, but the interesting thing, and we're going to get to this, is that bit has another meaning, okay? And that meaning means house, but not in the way of physical. It means house, your house, meaning your family, your people. Okay? Now, the next in people, place, and thing is place, right? We often think of place as where our family resides to. And in David's time, Jerusalem was the place. And in fact, it is still at this stage of history, And we know and associate Jerusalem to the nation of Israel, to the Jews. Interestingly enough, and before I go into the whole people group thing, because we're kind of connecting place and people at this point. If you're not aware, the northern kingdom of the ten tribes was not recovered. So if you're not aware, the nation of Israel today, they primarily and only relate their lineage to the tribe of Judah and Benjamin. So if you think about Israel, it is not the 12 tribes today. Okay? Which is, did you know that? Yeah, some of you, I see some heads nodding, some not. And what we see in this passage, God's covenant, it says, I'm going to establish your house forever. Yes, I'm going to have your son build a temple. I'm going to establish it in this place called Jerusalem. But very shortly, we see the destruction of the temple. We see the destruction of the national unity of the nation of Israel. And so we think, what happened to God's promise? Right? What happened to his covenant, which is a powerful covenant when it comes to establishing and foretelling of Jesus? Right? It's as powerful as the covenant that was given to Abraham. David is obviously coming from the line of Abraham. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. Eventually, David down the line. Now, I want to ask, I want to put this in perspective. How many of you know your national origin? Meaning German, Swedish. What was your, is it just Swedish?
Swedish and Scotch.
Yeah. Swedish and Scotch. Yeah? You guys have done tests?
No.
Give me a few.
Romanian.
What?
German and Romanian.
German and Romanian.
Irish.
Irish.
French.
Scots.
French.
French. Swedish. Scottish.
Welsh.
Polish.
Native American.
Native American. Dutch.
Indian.
I was hoping you would speak out, Miss. Okay. Now, how many of you have done genealogy? Your gene, meaning your family name. Yeah, a few of you. I remember actually a few years back, I was sitting with my grandfather who's passed away, and he loved genealogy. And I can't remember what year it was, but he showed me some documents, and it fascinated me because he took me all the way back to kind of the original Geigler, German, who came over to Charleston on a boat in the mid to late 1700s, and I believe he was a butcher, or at least there was a butcher in our family history at some point. But how many can trace your actual family name a few hundred years? Yeah?
Yeah.
How many can trace it more than 300 years? There's a few. Okay. How about 500 years? That's a long time.
Hello.
Okay. So, we think of these, now, in America today, we think, you know, my grandparents, my great-grandparents, usually we don't go as further back when it comes to knowing anyone else in our line. But God doesn't work that way, right? God's covenant says, I'm going to establish your line forever. Now, the interesting tidbit of information to give you is between Abraham, which we know is basically the covenant that is kind of initiating the nation of Israel, which we'll find in his line through Jacob, whose name changed to Israel, we have about 950 years. Okay, now we think that's a long time between Abraham and David. Okay, now between David and Jesus. What is the number of years?
1,000.
Thank you, Jim. It's 1,000 years. So you see, between Abraham to King David, which still represents the ultimate kingship. He was a pre-Messiah, basically, figure in helping rid the land of enemies and establishing the nation. And then to Jesus, 1,000 years later, who, of course, we know is the Messiah. See, Jesus is thinking differently about timeline than we do. We go a few hundred years and we can't figure it out, but to the Jews, to that nation, their lineage, their culture, their people, is a different mindset than what we're used to. They still hold on to the thought that, at least Orthodox Jews, hold on to the thought that their Messiah is coming. And I often think, how do they do that? It's been a long time. And this is the answer. The answer is 1,000 years, they've done that before. When your people group has done 1,000 years, then you continue to wait. And so, we get to the point, though, of talking about people now. God has established his covenant with David that says, "My line, your line will last forever." And we know it's talking about Jesus. And we see at this point, God basically promises David three things. He's going to make the name of David great. He's going to appoint a place for Israel and will plant them. And he'll give him rest from all his enemies. So these are just three promises to David himself. And David, it says, at this point gets to rest. But ultimately, we see this promise of a king that will be established in his line. A lasting promise that it is hard to comprehend for us. But we see that in Ephesians. At this point, God is trying to gather the nation of God. And I'm not just talking about Israel. God is pulling all those who are now established in his name under his house. And so we are part of the household that Jesus is talking about when it comes to his promise to David. Yes, we are adopted in. I don't know that anyone except for maybe Bob Vogel has Jewish in their DNA. But establishing his household together, I will establish your house for all generations. And at this stage, we know his house continues to grow and expand and inviting other peoples in as part of his temple, as part of the living castle, the living sanctuary, the living fortress that hosts God's presence is in the people itself. And what does this mean for us? Because I have, of course, a few questions to leave you with. First is what thing in your life has captivated you as a spiritual focal point? Because remember, we may look at the cross as a reminder of who Jesus is, but it should never be the thing that directs us. And I don't necessarily mean the cross. I mean basically our buildings, our things in our life. Yes, they can remind us of God's goodness, but they shouldn't be the thing that leads us or directs us. So what might in your life be the thing that is directing you rather than keeping you focused on God? Second is, what place reminds you of God's presence? Now, we might say church, but remember that God is found anywhere. In fact, it says in Ephesians, wants to fill the whole universe with Christ. For it's in all, through all, that Christ will be established, that keeps things going. And so do we see God's presence in the places that we might not attribute it? Do we see God at work? And lastly, do you see God's image around you, in yourself? But do you see God's image in those people around you, especially those that maybe you're not sure if that is the image of God? Why? Because we are of the household of God. God established his covenant through David, and it continues through us. And are we representing God? Are we making it known, God's presence, whether it's in a thing, a place, or people? Are we drawing it out? For that's what a priest does. That's what those who are called to be of the royal line of David, the royal line of Jesus, is called to do, is to say, that's not a T. That's representing Jesus. Thank you, Lord. This isn't just a church building. It reminds us that God is here in our communities. That's not just an enemy. That's a person who needs to be reminded that they're made in the image of God. And what does all this mean? That God is establishing His kingdom, that God is establishing His glory on earth as it is in heaven. So this week, I challenge you, I remind you to look at whether it's things, places, people, that God is there. And as a priest, as royalty, it's our job to initiate, to call out, to remind, and to give God glory in what He has made. Let's pray. Holy Spirit, I thank You. Thank You that You are leading us. It is not a temple we rely on. It's not even the ark that we rely on. It is Your very presence that You have given us. Holy Spirit, lead us as the house of God in calling out, in treasuring those things that are around us that bring You glory, that is made to bring You glory. We praise You. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So stand and join with me in our last hymn together, number 38. Son. Amen.
Amen. Amen.